Okay, the next presenter is Rongshan Qin from Imperial College London, who will be talking about the applications of his work of electropulsing in steel formation.
Thank you very much. I'm interested in treat steel in extremely short time. So how short is that? If you blink your eye once, I should have done my experiment 1,000 times. That means if you blink your eye take 0.1 second, and my experiment should take less than 100 microseconds. Okay. So I'll firstly show some of the result, and then we'll discuss the mechanism about this. The way I'm using is electric current pulse. Okay, because it's very short time, it's a pulse. And I use electric current pass through the steel. So I have quite a few authors here, and I especially should acknowledge those people who are also interested in this very special processing method. They sponsored the project, and also those are people who helped me a lot. So let me first show you some results. So it doesn't work. Oh, it's a cup. Yeah. Okay. So this is a piece of steel. It's a commercial paralytic steel. We contain 0.8% of carbon. It's a commercial one. You can see it everywhere. So the sample was more than 10 centimeters long, and the diameter is about 2 millimeters. So the microstructure, if you look at the microstructure in microscope, so it should be like this, because I could draw the steel wire with 60% of reduction at room temperature, cold draw date, so without any annealing afterwards. So if you look at the mark structure, it's something like this. This is a cementite plate. The ferrite is etched away, okay? So this is the one. And then I put this steel into my processing facility at room temperature with one pulse. So totally, it's less than 100 microseconds. At that, during the time, you don't see anything happen. You didn't hear a voice, so bang or something. And you didn't see the steel wire actually become powder or whatever. It's a steel wire, and you didn't see the color of the steel wire change into some others, like a red color or so. And afterwards, I put my finger on the steel wire and didn't feel, I can't hold my finger on the wire. So that's a kind of phenomenon. However, if you see that steel wire at SEM, you see there's a cementite plates. Originally was this, now changed into this. Okay? Be careful of the scale. Here is a 500 nanometer. So in this 10 centimeter steel wire, I choose 12 different points, exam, and everywhere got exactly the same mark structure. Those cementite plates change into a particle with average size of 30 nanometers. So when we examine the mechanical property, we found this one, weak hardness of this one was about 400. And this one was a little bit higher than this. You know, this is a cold drawn without annealing. And this one has already removed all the internal stress, and it is still much harder than this. Another surprising what we found is electrical conductivity of this state is improved 100%. It's almost a double. The electrical conductivity of this steel is almost a double of this. So that is one situation for paralytic steel wire. And then I have another one. This is another steel. Okay, we call it trip steel. However, at the moment, it's a hot rolled steel and without any retained austenite, although we call it trip. So if you look at here, we have a lot of ferrite particles here, combined with this complicated microstructure. If you look at this, you do not see any anisotropy here. Microstructurally, you don't see that. And again, at room temperature, electropulse, this steel with 3,000 times, passes through 3,000 pulses through this piece of steel at room temperature at a frequency of 1 hertz, which means each second I pass through 1 pulse, and the pulse width at this moment is 20 microseconds. Okay, so after 3,000 times, if you put that into optical microstructure, you will see a lot of lines, black lines, along the electrical current direction. This is an image of SEM. You see this original isotropic property has completely lost. All of these phases change into this along the electric current direction. So if you use a higher resolution SEM, you will see even inside those lines, the cementite and the ferrite lines are all along the electric current direction. So now we are interested to develop a steel with all the with this kind of microstructure. It's everywhere, not only just this. So this is again at room temperature for this steel. So now let me show you another example. So this is a 316L stainless steel. We know this problem with this steel is if you do an annealing, and then secondary phase will fall. So if you anneal that at a temperature around 1,000 degrees, you will see a lot of those white particles. Those are secondary phase particles. So this 316L stainless steel contains very high chromium, moly, and nickel. So if you form these secondary particles, so these secondary particles are very rich in chromium and molybdenum. So in that case, the area surrounding this will have a poor chromium and a poor moly. So if these things happen, and then those poor chromium and the poor moly area will have poor corrosion resistance. So we try not to have these secondary phase particles. However, it's very, very difficult to do. So what we are doing is we put two samples in the furnace, exactly same samples, but one of them linked with electropulsing, another without. So when we did a heat treatment and then analyzed two samples. One of them is this microstructure, another is this microstructure. So the secondary phase is not formed. The electropulsing has suspended the formation of secondary phase. That's one thing. You see much less secondary phase particles at this side. Again, if we analyze the composition inside here, we find even though we formed some secondary phase particles, inside the chromium and the molybdenum difference between the particle and the matrix are much, much smaller. So by this one, our electropulsing has reduced the segregation of this chromium, nickel, and moly in stainless steel. So that's another thing we have done. So now let me tell you another result, which we just made very recently, but this has already published. Okay, this is we use this technology at a liquid steel. So it's in liquid state. In one, the sample here is 1.5 centimeter diameter ingots. Okay, we melt that without electropulsing and cool down. What we see is inside this steel, we have a lot of manganese sulfur inclusions. Okay, so those inclusions are almost round shape and distributed everywhere. If you look, examine your cast, it's everywhere. However, if we do the same thing, but connect with our electropulsing for 20 minutes. Pulse is 20 microseconds, each pulse is 20 microseconds, and use a frequency of 1 hertz. And then what we found, things that very differently, is inside the ingots, internal ingots, is inclusion free. All the inclusions are gone from inside. However, at a boundary, top, side, and some of the bottom, we have lots of inclusions. All the inclusions are moved from the central part to the outside part. So the ideal way is we put slag on top of that and collect all the inclusions so that we can make soup clean steels. So this is the one thing. So we have expelled inclusions from inside the steel, liquid steel, to the surface. Another thing, what we noticed is, at this case, this is almost a spherical particle. Now look at it here. All the manganese sulfur inclusions form this very strange morphology. It's almost everywhere. This is something very strange, and we don't really know what's that. Has electro pulse affected the interfacial energy? Otherwise, why don't this go to a round shape? Round shape will have much smaller surface area and a lower free energy. So that's some of the experiments we have found using our facility. Now let's come into the detail of the technology and analyze what's happening and what can be done further. Okay. So firstly, when I talk about passing through high density electric current to steel, many people immediately think there's a heat there. Okay? So now let's calculate what kind of heat has generated by this electric current. I can very easily to go through this. I know people don't like the equation, but this equation is very special because they are so easy. And we know them from the secondary school. So if we calculate the total energy added by this electro pulsing. So in my facility, I have two different options. One is I can fix the voltage. Another is I can fix the current, electric current. So suppose I fix the electric current, and that this is the current, this is the electrical resistance of the sample, and this is the pulse duration. So use this equation, so I can calculate the total energy of this electric current pulse, okay? Now, I suppose all those energy has changed into heat and heat up the sample, okay? So in that case, I have, this is the total mass of the sample, this is specific heat of sample, and this is the temperature rising. So suppose all of the electric current didn't do anything else, just the heat of the sample. And then this equal to this. From here, I can immediately get the temperature rising due to one pulse is this, just this divided by MC, okay? So here, again, this is the resistance of the sample. I can calculate resistance of sample equals to the density multiplied by the length of sample divided by the cross-section area of the sample, okay? I have this R. And this is a mass equals the density of the sample, steel sample, multiplied the volume of sample. So it's the length, the cross section. So if I substitute R to here, M to here, and I get the temperature rising due to one electro pulsing should be this, and because current divided by cross section area is the current density, so I can actually have this. So you know it's a very, very simple mathematics, and I have assumed all the electric current energy has been converted to the heat, to heat up the sample. And then let's apply this one to a calculation. I substitute all the parameter of 316L stainless steel in capacity, heat capacity, this density, we know 7.8, and its electrical resistivity is this, okay? Now, what I need is each pulse is 20 microseconds, and this is current density. Look, this is astonishing high. Actually, what I used to generate those results are not that high. This is 100 times higher than what I used. So it's ridiculously high. So because I want to do a maximum calculation, so I use 100 times higher than what I actually use. If you substitute all of that into this, so each pulse can actually increase the temperature of sample by 0.217 degree. Okay, it's nothing. And remember, for all the experiment I use, the pulse frequency is 1 hertz. So if I put that in, that means the heating up rate is 0.217 K per second. You know, in steel processing, this is nothing, and it's almost 100 times higher than what I've done. This is average kind. But some people may argue, okay, there's a percolation here. Somewhere got a high density than other place, but I already have used 100 times higher than the average. So that's one thing. So the electropulsing effect is not a heat effect. Okay, that's one thing. Another thing is, some people say you can do this in a laboratory because your sample is small, but you may not be able to scale up to industry because industry need to have a very, very big steel. So can you do that? Let's calculate the energy consumption in the pulse. So the total work in single electropulsing is this. Okay, it's the same. So required electric power is a work divided by time. So here I got a pulse frequency. You know, I normally use 1 hertz. So if we substitute all the parameters we used before in, get all those parameters in, so each pulse actually consumed power need to generate this electropulse process is 0.304 watts. That's again nothing. So I can tell you in my laboratory, the facility I used to generate electropulsing is 80 watts. And the electric current was generated at an electrical potential of 20 volts. So for that kind of power, it's nothing, because in our home, we can easily find a bulb. The power is 100 watts, and my facility is only 80. So it's very easy to scale up. So by those, we know we can apply this, but what is the mechanism? Okay, so there's one thing, it's complicated. I don't believe we have solved this. But one thing is, let's analyze this from thermodynamics way. So if we have some mark structure change, whether phase transition or just the structure relaxation or whatever, so the total free energy at here is free energy change is a chemical free energy change plus surface energy change plus electric current associated free energy change. Okay, those two we all know, but what about this term? So this one, fortunately, we know this one can be calculated by this equation. So this equation is free energy associated with the electropulsing equals, this is the magnetic permeability, 8 pi. This is the current density distribution after the Mach structure evolution, okay? This is the current density distribution before the Mach structure evolution. And then you have this term which make this calculation very complicated, very, very nonlinear. So what we have done is we have actually developed a software. We are able to calculate the current distribution, if you have any kind of phase transition or any kind of Mach structure change, not only phase transition. For example, if I have an inclusion, at the moment, inclusion is here, But the next moment, the inclusion move up to here. So if you look at that case, it's a chemical-free energy difference. It's the same. You don't have anything to change because there's no phase transition. This one is the same, but this one is different. Because if you have an inclusion move from this part to the surface, and then you have a completely different electric current distribution. So if you have this completely different electric current distribution, you will have a completely different free energy change. And then, because that one, so some of the move will be favored by this electro pulsing, but some of them will not. Okay, so that's a case about inclusion removing. So we tested this against the, so this is a show of analyze for the electric current distribution, and we are able to calculate all the free energy change. This is something like our pyrite in a layered structure, but that one, all the layers actually separate into this small disintegrated part, similar type, and we are able to calculate the current density distribution, and again, we can get a total free energy. So we will be able to know in this electro pulsing, you actually will let your grays to separate into different several things, or you actually will have a coarsening. So this one, when we calculate, use the equation to calculate the microstructure refinement, because sometimes we use that. So we and this is our theoretical value, and this is an experimental value, not did by ourselves. It's did by a group in America, Professor Hans Corrander's group. So we see it's agreed very well. And we further predicted and say we can use this electro pulsing to fabricate nanostructure material. Those are required current density. Those are all theoretical work. And again, we found if we use electro pulsing, we are able to increase the fatigue life of the material. So we calculated that if we, for different material, if we use electric current density above a certain value, and we are able to heal the crack. So we have done this before, and we were able to improve the fatigue life of low carbon steel for 34 times. Okay, so those are just my adventure in this steel processing is the conclusions. Thank you very much.
Okay, that's a very novel topic there indeed. And does anyone have any questions? Straight away, yes. See if we can get both our microphones over to Ms. Rowe. Just use that one.
Thank you very much for your great presentation. So you show us the microstructure change due to the electric current. So the last part of this presentation, you said just thermodynamic approaches. But to change the microstructure, we must consider the kinetics.
Exactly.
So what do you think on that?
We did some work, and also in literature, you can find some work. Passing electric current can lower the kinetic barrier of some transformation, but in another group of transformation, electric current can actually increase the kinetic barrier. So there are some works, and we also did some. However, kinetic understanding of this mechanism is very poor at the moment. There are a lot of things we don't understand.
Your pulsing time is very short, I think, right?
Yeah.
So one second or below the 1 second.
Yeah,
okay?
If you use one pulse, it's certainly less than 100 microseconds. Yeah, pulse time is very short. there are some solid result people found is electropulsing can increase the diffusivity many times. That's the people agreed. Another is change the kinetic barrier. Some of them reduce a lot or even completely remove the kinetic barrier. Another case, you can actually increase the kinetic barrier. But for rest of things, it's very, very basic in early stage.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Joe.
Thank you. You talked about the implied putting this into industry is a limit on the sample size, and you said that the power doesn't limit it. Is there a limit imposed by the magnetic skin effect? That if you actually want to put a sharp rise and fall of current into something, the current only tends to flow through the surface of the thing you're applying to.
So the skin effect is related to the current frequency.
Yep.
So you can calculate that accurately. If you use a direct current, and then you won't have a skin effect at all.
Right, but you're pulsing it though. Is that not equivalent to a single wave of an AC pulse?
Need to calculate it because, for example, a lot of automotive steels. So what we are interested in is a thin plate.
Yes.
Or steel wires.
Yeah.
For those in a few centimeter or a few millimeter thickness.
Yeah. Yes.
You can ignore that.
Right,
if you calculate by 1 hertz,
okay.
If you increase the frequency.
It's not the 1 hertz, though, is it? Is it not the 20 microsecond period that actually determines the skin effect?
It's a hertz.
It's not, the 1 hertz is the limiting.
1 hertz.
All right, so that's quite deep, though.
If you use a very high hertz, a very high frequency, for example, 300 hertz, and you see the skin effect. So in that time, there are some of the experiments reported before. People use that to modify the surface property of the material. They can actually generate amorphous at the surface layer of the material.
Deliberately do it. Okay,
yeah,
right.
Extremely very high frequency.
Interesting idea.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
Okay.
Yes, Longshan, thank you for your interesting presentation. I have a very basic question, like you did, very elementary calculation in the beginning. So if you are going to melt steel with an electric arc furnace, normally you spend something around 400 kilowatt hours for ton. So let's say 4 kilowatt hours for kilogram. So do you have any a number for something on mass of iron, of course, or anything about related moles, about your pulse? So how much energy really spent for unit of mass in your process, basically. Comparing it to the melting energy, roughly speaking, the entropy of melting, we know, which is a good number for any metal.
Okay. Yeah. So the total amount of energy we spend is extremely small. It's not comparable with your melting material or heat up material. So extremely small, what we did the calculation. So this can be illustrated by our facility. So my facility, the power is only 80 watts. So what can you do with 80 watts facility? If you have a bulb, it's 100 watts. You will not be able to heat up steel by 100 watts bulb. So the energy consumed here is extremely small. If you want to lift up your temperature, you have to use other ways to increase the temperature, not by this. This is just to induce those microstructure, but not heat, not left up the temperature.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we've just got time for maybe two more questions. So I'll come down to Pedro at the front, who's been waiting a while, and then we'll go to you at the back.
Okay, a very interesting talk. Two short questions. One is the parameter for liquid processing is the same as the solid state processing. The second question is the ingredients, many kinds of ingredients. Some are electric conductive, some are not electric conductive. Was any results on different kinds of ingredients in steels?
We only did this inclusion, first of all, manganese sulfur. Because the history is like this. Although I showed you all the experiments firstly, but the history is that we got a theory firstly. So we got equation and calculation, and then use that to apply for funding. So I got a funding and hired a postdoc, and then start experiments. That's the kind of story. so when we did the calculation, we found is this remove inclusion by this method is completely different from the existing method of removing inclusion. Existing method use other physical properties like density or size of inclusion or those kind of things. But this is according to the electrical property difference. So in non-metallical inclusion normally is not conductive. And your liquid steel got reasonably good conductivity. So, and then when we start the calculation, we can choose obvious more important is alumina inclusion or whatever. But those manganese sulfur have relatively high conductivity than alumina or silica. So we tried the most difficult one, and the first try was successful. So we still do other inclusions, remove it, and try to optimize the technology.
Thank you.
Okay, one last question, Pedro.
Okay, you mentioned the refinement of the pyrolytic structure associated to a hardness increase, but you didn't mention which one was that. One of your first slides was the refinement, the fragmentation of the pyrolytic structure.
Yeah.
And you mentioned there was a hardness improvement, but I couldn't hear which one was that.
Mm.
The other thing is that for that case, I made a quick mental calculation based on 0.2 joules per square meter of interfacial energy, and it came to the staggering amount of 10 to the 4 watts to fragment that microstructure.
Mm.
So am I doing something wrong in the calculation, and what is the hardness increase?
Only this one, we got a hardness increase, because what we found is because you form the nanostructure.
Marginally increase.
This is about 430, this is about 455. But important thing is, this one, you got all the stress here, internal stress here. This one, you have completely removed the stress. So this one, you are not able to draw it anymore. But that one, you can draw it to double its stress. So that's the case.
So if the interlamellar spacing is 100 nanometers, you'll have about 10 to the 4, 10 to the 2 meters of interface in a cube of 1 cubic centimeter.
Mm.
And that gives you, for those pulses, 10 to the 4 watts. What is wrong in my calculation?
10 to the 4.
It could be percolation. So if you, the current, talk about that also. So the current can go along the green boundaries, let's say, for a moment.
But you need to say the interfaces are broken or created.
So this is an interesting idea. Yeah. So when you talked about the percolation, you talked about it correctly.
Yeah.
So free energy balance.
I agree.
Yeah.
But remember that if the energy is given only to the interfaces.
Yeah. So, yes, you're right. So we did a calculation. When we first done this, we did a calculation. If you just use original all the surface energy, transform the original surface energy to the particle, what we found is this size we got is smaller than your theoretical size.
Yeah.
So we should have a big one, but we actually got a smaller one. A problem is that we have put in those extra energy by electro pulsing.
Okay, this might run. You can talk about this afterwards. I'm afraid we have to move on. So thank you, Roger.